now, basically.
Okay, cool. I think we should be ready to start the workshop now. Before we jump in, I just want to say we are super excited to be taking part in March Interfaith Week, and we are very grateful to our brilliant speaker, Hamza, for giving this lecture on prominent debates in religion. His accomplishments are too many to name in this brief introduction, so I will not attempt to get into his full CV, but he is the best speaker of Europe in 2020, as well as the Oxford IV in 2020. This is obviously a very important topic, and I'm sure that the workshop will be excellent and useful to everyone who is here or will be watching this on live stream. So with that, Hamza, please feel free to start sharing your screen whenever you're ready.
Great. Thank you for the introduction, Bria. Watch me live it down. Give me one second. Andrea, would you mind giving me hosting rights on Natalie, please, just so I can share my screen?
Yeah, Natalie can do that.
Perfect.
Should have rights.
Yep, it's coming up. Thanks. One second. There we go. Wait, I've completely forgotten how to present. There we go. Great. So today we're going to do a workshop on religion. So just a few notes of housekeeping before we start. So one would be there's going to be a mixture of questions from both this call and questions from the live stream. So I'm assuming with the live stream, Brira and the members of the debate committee will be taking care of making sure that if there's any comments there, they can relay them to me. And the rule for the comments on the live stream and for the Zoom call are the exact same, which is just make yourself audible at any point and just interrupt me. That's perfectly fine. If you do it politely, brownie points. If you don't, that's also fine. But just to make sure that I don't have to keep track of the chat. The second thing is in terms of the content of this workshop. So one, please keep in mind that this workshop is being done from the perspective of how religion is used in debating, as opposed to a workshop on religion holistically. Naturally, a workshop on religion and debating touches on several aspects of religion, but that's something to keep in mind. The second thing to keep in mind in terms of the content is my personal perspective in terms of what my literacy with religion is. So broadly, what I've read is the canonical text for the three Abrahamic religions. I've read the Bhagavad Gita. I've read the Buddhist text, the Pitaka. That's pretty much it. But like, if there's something I'm missing there, or there's some specific thing that you want me to talk about, we can hopefully get into it. But that's the extent of my literacy with religious discussions. So let's get into it. The first question is, what is religion? And this often comes up in debates, not explicitly and implicitly, but implicitly. And there's three ways to think about this. So the first is, what is religion by definition? So if you had to define religion, most people would say that it's some sort of belief that you have. Sure. Is nationalism then a religion? Is capitalism then a religion? Is believing that Bernie Sanders will instate the Green New Deal then a religion? So it gets really tricky to define exactly what religion is. Then perhaps you can do it as a belief which ordains a certain set of practices. But then you again get into the similar pothole of what about several political movements, which not only have foundational ontological beliefs about the world, but also ordain that their believers and their followers take part in certain practices. That's the sort of first ambiguity that you run into with defining religion. But then the second ambiguity within the definition stuff is the wide basket case that you called religion generally, right? It's sort of like sports where you would put badminton, which is like we all played badminton, and Thai boxing, the most deadly sport on the planet, in the category of sports. And yet, in my mind, badminton and Thai boxing have nothing in common with each other. And yet, we would still treat them with the same vocabulary, calling them sports. And I think it's very similar with religion as well, where you have so many faiths across the world that it's difficult to find any common definition there. An interesting example that I always use is the example of Jainism. So Jainism is a faith which is literally built on the bedrock of non-violence. So if you ever met an extremist Jain, this would be someone who is so extreme in their faith, they would refuse to leave their chambers, refuse to step out for fear of hurting someone, hurting a bug if they step on it, all of that stuff. And then it collides with our sort of original or sort of common definition of what an extremist religious person would be. So again, remember that within debates in religion, you can always find a counterexample because there's just so many faiths to begin with. A second more productive way to look about in terms of religion is by observation. So what do they study and what do they practice? And here again, you run into problems, right? Because one can say that the Quran, for instance, is tended to be much more prescriptive, which is to say it sets down a set of rules. It's closer to a rule book, a guidebook, than let's just say the Old Testament, which is closer to a storybook, which is a lot more about stories and then sort of reverse engineering from that certain moral parables. So is that still a religion? Is it not? How strict and how explicit do rules have to be before they can be called religious? It's similar with practices, where some religions tend to be very, very loose in terms of what their central teachings are. So if you think of Buddhist teachings, especially in Zen Buddhism, let's just say, of the central teaching of cause and effect, the belief that the universe runs on this principle of cause and effect. The number of teachings that you can extrapolate from that are so various that it's hard to find a common ground. So you get stuck in the observation bit. What debaters usually do is that they think of religion by conceptualization. So religion as a political concept, religion as an economic concept, religion as a social concept, and then finally, religion as a spiritual concept. These are four modalities that we'll get into later, but always be mindful of the fact that it's very hard to define religion, and that's usually a virtue, not a vice, because that means that there's always a counter argument or a counter example you can find to anyone who attempts to make a generalization about religion. The next question then is religion true? Literally, is it true? And the reason that this is important is because debaters often get into this business when they're talking about the clash between religion and science. The first thing to think about there is our general means of discovering truth. So our general means of discovering truth tend to be built on this empirical model that we call the falsification test, which basically means that you put up a hypothesis and then you throw experiments at it. And if you are unable to falsify it, then that thing is true. The reason that you get into trouble with religion there is because it says certain things which are difficult to falsify, right? So for instance, if someone makes the claim that Lazarus was revitalized, was resuscitated, if someone makes the claim that the prophet split the moon in two, if someone makes the claim that God created the earth in 7 days and seven nights, it's very difficult to falsify that claim because it is talking about things which lie outside the realm of our experimental model, outside of our empirical model. So that's the first difficulty you get into. But then that leads to the general discussion of why discovering truth would be important in the first place, right? In fact, many religious people would argue that it is precisely the fact that you cannot be sure that it's true that makes it faith to begin with, because otherwise it would literally just be a set of factual axioms, right? A lot of faith is premised around this idea that there is some uncertainty as to whether what is written in the text and what is followed is 100% true. And that's where the virtue of belief comes from. It comes from a leap of faith where you partake in the idea that I'm not completely sure what I want to believe. And that's where reward and punishment and all of these things stem from. So remember that while our general means of discovering truth don't work very well with religious notions because they're just impossible to falsify, it is true that it might have a clash with our general goal of discovering truth, where in many areas of our life, we want to be 100% certain as to whether something is true. For instance, when you sit down for operative surgery, you want to know what the doctor is doing, but that's not true for many other areas of our life, right? So for instance, if you wake up one day and your partner is next to you, you don't try to experiment with them to see if they 100% love you, right? Like a part of it is about the uncertainty of not knowing, and it's a leap of faith. So we have that attitude to many things in our lives. The next thing then is, how can we rethink truth in a way that fits religion? And this leads to the first discussion of what I call the three theories of truth. So generally speaking, that there's three ways to think about truth. The first is this way that we mostly think about truth, which philosophers call the correspondence theory of truth. All that means is that something is true if and only if it's true. Now, that sounds a bit circular, so let me explain what that means. So the sentence, I am wearing a black scarf, is true if I am wearing a black scarf. So it's a very common sense definition of how we think about truth. But there's also other ways to think about truth which might also work. So the second conception of truth is belief-based truth. And this is something which says that something is true if you genuinely believe it. Now, you might think that this sounds a bit idiotic, but this is something, again, that we apply to many, many areas of our life, right? Like, you genuinely believe that you're a good person, which makes you think that you're a good person. So you thinking you're a good person is definitely true, right? If you genuinely believe that you, I don't know, like really like someone or love your family or whatever, then that belief makes it true for you. It feels true to you at an emotive level, which lies again outside our experimental order of things. But then the most interesting one is the so-called utilitarian conception of truth, which basically says that what is true is whatever it is best to believe to be true. So for instance, if you come up with a sentence or a claim or an axiom or a principle, which if everyone believed to be true would just make things better, then that would be true from the utilitarian conception of things. So there's lots of examples that you can think of. A negative example would be, let's just say that you're like, you know, a person in a lab coat, like you're a scientist and you're working hard, like in Oxford or whatever. And then you come up with this, like, you know, interesting genetic intelligence sort of research. And, you know, you're sitting there and you're like, so this research says that, I don't know, South Asian people or people of South Asian origin have less genetic intelligence than non-South Asian people. Now, in your experimental order of things, that research is true, but you also know that it is better for the world not to know it, neither to believe it, because, for instance, it might legitimize the claims of the far right. It might lead to systematic and explicit racism against members of South Asian communities. It might make their intelligence outcomes even worse if you start denying them schooling and all of that stuff. So there's lots of reasons not to believe it. And the flip could be, what if you think of a positive thing that everyone should believe to be true? So let's just say that you find research, archaeologically speaking, which shows that the most important civilization, and this is actually true, by the way, right? So when you had research in the 80s, which showed that basically all of us came from 10,000 people in Africa, like that's what the human population dwindled down to a few hundred thousand years ago. That's a really interesting racial equalizer, isn't it? Because we have so many ideas of racism and hierarchy and whiteness, but just the intuition that all of us were nothing more than 10,000 people stranded in Africa and just got really lucky and then became the civilization that we are is the sort of belief that everyone should believe in, and hence it makes things better. The second way to rethink truth in the context of religion is the idea of the ever-expanding tautology. And this is often a technique that's used in religion to make religion reconcile itself with the claims of scientific findings. So for instance, if you think of, let's just say, a person sitting next to you, and then they say, you know, God created the universe, and then you say, so I've seen some recent research from the Large Hadron Collider, and it has given me experimental proof that, you know, the Earth was created because of the universe was created because of the Big Bang. And then this person replies very interestingly that, oh, wow, that's really beautiful and amazing. It turns out God is even smarter than we thought he was in the first place, right? So what's happened there is that religion is very flexible. Religion can take in the claims that science develops over the last two or three centuries and then the centuries which after, and then just use them to say, hence, this is more evidence of God's complexity, of God's beautiful design, of God's good intentions. So remember that no scientific claim necessarily disproves religion, because religion is flexible enough to envelope those scientific claims within itself as further evidence of its truth. The third thing to think about then, from the perspective of truth and religion, is the idea of cognitive dissonance. So cognitive dissonance is usually used as a negative term. It came up in psychological circles in the 1950s. And basically all it means is that you're contradictory on some level. So for instance, if you keep, posting Greta Thunberg memes on Facebook supporting her, but then fly every 2 months for a holiday to Aruba, then that's some cognitive dissonance happening there, right? Like your actions don't clearly align with your thoughts, and it can be your speech not clearly aligning with your thoughts. But I think that in religious spaces, cognitive dissonance can often be a virtue. So sort of the canonical example I've given in 6 different workshops like this is the example of my aunt, who's a gynecologist. And the example there is pretty simple, right? Like she's a woman of science, she's a really good gynecologist, but she's also a fairly orthodox Muslim. And while some people might see a contradiction in there, I don't and she doesn't, because it's simply the case that her ontology, her science of being is different in the lab, different in the hospital than it is from in the mosque or within religious circles. Because when she goes in and then starts treating her patients, right, she views the world from a fundamentally different prism than the world that she views 2 hours later when she bows her head in prayer. And that's not necessarily a contradiction, because it's happening in different spaces, right? And if you think about it, this is something that we all do. We are always different people in front of different people, not because we've watched House of Cards or we've read Machiavelli and we want to be tactical and manipulative and, you know, deception and all of that stuff. It's just that it's our social response. We just believe and view things differently when we're around different social situations. So that's another interesting way in which religion can sort of skip over this question of truth by arguing that there's a cognitive dissonance at play here. You don't even have to address the question of whether religion clashes with science, because they're both operating in different spaces. Before I move on towards the next section, Brira, just keep in mind if there's questions coming in, you can audibly interrupt me.
Okay, will do.
Okay, perfect. Let's talk about the next thing. Does religion change? This is perhaps the most important political question with respect to religion. It in some way influences everything from religious wars to the war on terror to LGBT inclusion to whatever it is. So this is a really fundamental question for religion. Does religion change? There's 3 ways to think about religion changing. First is, does religion have the capacity for change? And the answer is yes, in sort of a bunch of ways. The first way in which religion has the capacity for change is to be vague about things. So what that means is that if it's not very prescriptive about, let's just say, the position of the LGBT community or the position of women in the workplace or the inclusion of racial minorities within their circles, then that's just something that you can shoehorn in, right? Because you don't necessarily need to go over the text, because the text either does not speak about it at all, or the text speaks about it very vaguely. So you can put something in there which works. The second thing that you can do is that you can create change by analogy. And this is something that's often done within religious circles as well, where what you do is that you say, okay, can we think of a progressive scripture which exists and then use that scripture to find another progressive outcome? So a classic example, for instance, used by feminists in Pakistan, is to often use the Quranic scripture which states that heaven lies at the door of a mother, the doors of heaven lie at a mother's feet. And they say that this shows that, you know, motherhood and the position of women is extremely important in Islam. And by that, using that scripture, they sort of reverse engineer outcomes towards gender equality in the workplace, all of that stuff. So you can sort of debate by analogy to also find progressive outcomes. But let's think of the worst case. Let's just say that there's a place where religion just explicitly says something very, very clearly, and it's the thing that you don't want it to say. What do you do there? The answer for many centuries has been to ignore it. And that's perfectly fine. This is something that religions have been doing for a while now. So for instance, if you think of the Old Testament and you think of the position of the Amalekites, the Old Testament, to put it frankly, was basically endorsing genocide. But what people do now is that they take that specific scripture and they would say, no, this was a endorsement specifically of that one war, and nothing else. So it does not at all inform our rules for what happens in the future. You can think of similar things that we do with the sort of complicated relationship that the idea of slavery has with the three major Abrahamic texts, where wherever the point comes up, you can sort of simply skip over it and then focus on the more progressive aspects of the text. The point of this being that you shouldn't necessarily think that just because something is written in stone within a text means that it's fundamentally unchangeable. We've been using these religious texts in a wide variety of contexts and in many different ways for a long, long time now. And that's not going to stop. Sometimes ignoring them and expunging them from your collective memory is better for the religion and better for the faith. But those are ways in which religion can change. Abhijit, did you have a question?
Yeah. Is the precociousness to change or the ability to change limited to a privileged few?
Yeah. So that's question three. So that's a good question, actually. So I'm going to get to that when I talk about who changes religion. So I'll table that for a second. So that just sort of shows that religion can change. What about religions wanting to change, right? What are the incentives for change to begin with? So one trivial thing that we should definitely talk about there is that religions want to have more followers. Like, that's just literally true, right? So religions have an incentive to universalize their teachings as much as possible. And part of doing that necessarily means that you allow more and more people to come within your fold. So sort of one of the clearest examples of this is the position of the Mormon Church with respect to the Curse of Ham. So the Curse of Ham is this biblical teaching, or one can say sort of a bastardization of that biblical teaching, which basically says that there was this person, Ham, this person had dark skin, and hence there's a curse inflicted on this person. It's sort of the simplistic version of the story. And this Curse of Ham idea was used to, in many ways, disenfranchise and discriminate against people of African origin, because now they felt that they had a biblical footing to do so. That teaching sort of just disappeared from Mormon circles in the 1960s. And you'll remember that something else was happening in the 1960s in the United States, which was the civil rights movement, right? So by the end of the 1960s, they just sort of forgot about it. And then suddenly, like, recruitment of the Mormon Church within African-American spaces started going up. And again, this has to do with religion A, having incentives to recruit, but B, also remember religion having incentives to so-called keep up with the times. This is different from just wanting to get followers, right? It's whether the perception of that religion is modern or archaic. So if you think of, let's just say, someone like what the current Pope is doing right now in terms of traveling to Iraq, meeting with the Sistani there, meeting with the clerics, all of that stuff, that gives off the image of modernity. So it's not like the Pope is going to convince, like, you know, Shia clerics to convert to Catholicism anytime soon, but it's much more about showing that it's a modern idea, an idea of the 21st century to have interfaith harmony amongst different faiths. So that's a second incentive that you have, the perception and the optics of the religion. The third incentive that you have to change is simply that you often have to grapple with secular law in many parts of the world. So those often constrain what you can and can't do, and that often changes how you practice religion. So a very classic example of this, I'll give two extreme examples. So one less extreme example is the position of halal slaughter. So halal slaughter, for people who don't know, is this idea that meat which is consumed by members of the Muslim community has to be slaughtered in a certain way, and that is known as halal slaughter, simplistically. There's been a huge debate over the last 15 years on whether halal slaughter is the correct way to slaughter meats. And there's been a bit of a clash between animal rights activists and also members of the Muslim community. And sort of the logic that interplayed there was very interesting, where many imams in Europe, where this debate was taking place, said, look, the reason that we were using this specific technique and called it halal was because the Prophet taught us that we should cause minimal pain to animals. So at the time, this was just the minimally painful way to do it. However, now that the animal rights activists are suggesting stunning, which is just stun the animal to death, so there's zero pain, it's completely immediate, we're happy to consider that. We're happy to look at that because it follows the same reasoning that our own previous techniques did. This is an interesting example where they were grappling with secular law within the European Union and just sort of modified and evolved their teachings and prescriptions accordingly to, again, so-called fit the times and fit the teachings of the 21st century. So these are three incentives for why religion does change. And one can think of many others as well, from donations to political recognition to making it look like you have a multicultural following. So there's lots of things that you can think of there. But the point is that religion wants to change. It's not that just that religion can change. The question then becomes, as Abhijit asked, who changes religion, right? So this is actually a tricky question, because one will notice that often religious change comes most often from places which are higher up in the religious hierarchy. So for instance, if the Pope endorses, or more accurately, drops his opposition against LGBT marriage, that's going to create a lot more waves than a local bishop doing it in Boston, right? Similarly, if the Grand Imam of the Holy Kaaba issues a statement which is against violence committed by, let's just say, members of the LGBT community, that's likely to hold much more water in the community than something which comes from one imam in one mosque in Pakistan. So while religion has a capacity for change, it is changing. While religion wants to change, there are incentives for change. It is an unfortunate truth that often religious reform can only come from the inside and not the outside. Now, this might even be a good thing, right? Where you might say that we don't want foreign intervention. We don't want outsiders to come in and tell us what our religious precepts are or should be. But it is at the same time true that this often manifests itself in hierarchies developing, and then it's only members at the top of the hierarchy who can most enact this change. And obviously, members of these hierarchies often have incentives which are different from members at the bottom of these hierarchies. So one can imagine that when change does occur, change is slow and change is limited, but at the same time, change can occur. Abhijit, does that answer your question?
It does, thank you.
No worries. Brie, are there any more questions before I move on to the next section? Okay, great. Leaving and joining religion, how does that work? First, we'll cover the costs of leaving, then we'll cover the benefits of joining. So firstly, what are the costs of leaving? So some costs are external. So in the most extreme case, one thinks of in a handful of countries, you have what are called apostasy laws, which basically state that if you leave the faith, specifically in this case, the Islamic faith, then you're going to serve some sort of criminal punishment. So that's in a very small minority of countries, just an explicit cost of leaving the religion. If you apostatize, then you're in trouble. But then the second one is that it's not just a legal problem, it's also a communal problem. So in the extreme case, again, what this might lead to is communal violence. What this might lead to is the community disenfranchising you. But even in the less extreme case, if you grow up in a predominantly Christian or Jewish or Muslim neighborhood, and then you go around saying, I am an atheist, I just watched a Christopher Hitchens video or whatever it is, then they might not necessarily commit violence or take away your legal status, but there might be a difference in their attitude towards you, right? So in other words, they might just become judgmental. If you're not going to the mosque with your friends every week, then what are you doing? Will they offer you the same opportunities? Will they think about you the same way? So it doesn't always have to manifest itself in legal criminal punishment or extreme communal violence. Often it's just the simple fact that a lot of your sense of community comes from being as part of a religious community. And you might lose some of that experience in some of those communities, the point at which you decide to leave the religion. The second part is, what are the internal costs of leaving religion? And this has to do with the psychological state that you're in when you're thinking of leaving religion. And I want you to think about this literally, right? So if you genuinely believe, as billions of people do, that there is a punishment attached to not believing, and there's a reward attached to believing, then it's actually very difficult to leave, right? Because heaven, and putting it another way, is an infinite benefit, and hell, putting it another way, is infinite harm. So then if you're thinking of leaving religion, but then you also believe, I either go to heaven and enjoy my life for infinity, or I burn in hell, it sort of becomes difficult to make that internal calculation. So it's not just external constraints on leaving, it's also the internal psychological conflict that you face in terms of leaving the faith. But then let's flip those and let's just talk about the benefits of joining. Often the benefits of joining are exactly the flip of it, right? So a sense of spiritual belonging, being more in tandem with the community, all of that stuff. In fact, the next few slides will all be about the benefits of joining. So we start now. First is a religion as a moral inquiry. And this is extremely important because a lot of people say that, you know, religion is outdated. If I had 30 minutes, I could write a better religious book, probably not true, and all of that stuff, right? But it's not necessarily about you being able to come up with better moral rules. It's about you being able to come up with rules which are more likely to be followed. These are two very different things. So religion makes people what I call more morally serious. What that means is that they are more likely to think about moral questions and more likely to follow on moral questions. So even if one buys the argument that, you know, religion teaches bad things and it's immoral and it only teaches very few good things, those very few good things often have a very high enforcement rate because people who go in there do believe it. Like, how many people realistically read Aristotle and the Socratic inquiry to come up with their moral principles, right? Like, apart from people at LSE, when's the last time you read like Kant's Critique of Pure Reason to be like, what is my deontological imperative, right? Like people read a book, like in fact, a holy book, one of the most popular books on the planet. Then they talk about it with other people in the mosque or the church or the synagogue, and then they come up with their moral rules. So religion's strength as a sense of moral inquiry doesn't necessarily come from the so-called quality, the moral quality of its precepts, but by how widely it is practiced and how it's a great avenue to push people to be better moral agents. That's the first one. Veera, were you about to come in? Okay. The next is religion as political spirit. How does that work? So there's this thing called liberation theology, which became really, really famous in the 1960s. This was just after the second major papal conference, John Paul II, all of that stuff. And basically what happened there was that people in Latin America started thinking, why don't we start using religious precepts to, in fact, push for political change? And the way this worked was that historically there's been this idea that, you know, blessed are the poor, for they will inherit the earth, all of that stuff. But then they started thinking, this doesn't necessarily have to mean we just stay poor so we inherit the earth. I think this means because we are poor, we should start trying to inherit the earth. And that's basically what Latin American activists started doing, where the church became a place of activism against right-wing dictatorships across Latin America. And this led to the toppling of some very terrible dictatorships and led to the ushering in of center-left socialist governments, which are more likely to be pro-poor. Now, how did religion achieve that? A couple of ways. First, think back to the thing I said about religion as moral inquiry. Religion talks about things in a language that really appeals to people. It's easier to talk about religion than it is to talk about, for instance, did you know what Marx said about, you know, social capitalism and the dialectic? Like, that doesn't appeal to people, right? Like, what appeals to people often are faith-based teaching. So one is just how easy it is for religion to be used as a tool of dissemination. If you go in and start teaching something in churches, people are much more likely to think about it, to buy it, to ponder over it, than if you go in and start talking about a hard philosophical or political philosophical text. But the second thing is that religion can inspire a sense of political bravery in you. So you almost become irrational, right? And this is an interesting example that you can think of both in the case of liberation theology in the 1960s and the Arab Spring. You almost have to not care if you will die in order to oppose some regimes and dictatorships. And religion inspires that sort of like all what we would just call irrational political bravery in you, because you start thinking of the struggle is not just about you, not just about the movement, it's the divinely correct thing to do. And that leads to a sense of bravery in you, which can inspire you to push for social change in the most difficult of circumstances. Now, obviously, some of you, the more skeptical, will be thinking, sure, but doesn't that also work in the flip, where people who have bad incentives can also use that sort of irrational bravery to cause harm? That's completely true, but then it just sort of depends on what context specifically you're looking at. Are you looking at brave, progressive protesters who are willing to be shot during the Arab Spring, or are you looking at a marginalized terrorist group? So that sort of just depends on what sort of example we're considering. The next one is religion as economic support. How does that work? So the first is just extremely obvious, which is that religion incentivizes charitable donations. Now, often people say that's not true because, you know, one, you can give to secular foundations, such as, let's just say, Médecins Sans Frontières, or that secular people give money as well. I think that sort of misses the point of how religion provides economic support. So it's not just the case that religions donate money. It's that something very interesting happens psychologically and communally when you're sitting in church or in a mosque, right? When someone comes up to you and says, this is the money that we're collecting, this is the chanda we're collecting, or whatever it is, there's something about that that says, like, you know, if I don't do it, I'm a sort of bad person. Where in secular circles, the idea of charity giving is a much more private sphere thing, whereas in religion, it's a much more public sphere thing. Everyone in the mosque puts some money in the bucket. Everyone in the church puts some money in the hat. Everyone in the synagogue gives money to the lady outside, right? So it's really interesting where there's a communal and psychological almost shaming structure, to put it a bad way, or encouragement structure, to put it in a good way, to incentivize charity giving, which doesn't happen in secular circles where it's a much more, I'm going to go online, then look it up and then do it. Whereas opposed to in a mosque with 500 people, if I don't do it, my friends will talk to me about this outside the mosque sort of thing. So it often incentivizes charity giving in a way that's different from secular structures. And then the second thing that the religion does in terms of economic support is that often creates trust-based societies. So what does that mean? Think about it this way. If you live in a village in Rwanda and you want to chip in money to make sure that you have, let's just say, a single road built from that village to, wait one second, let me admit. If you want to build a single road that goes from like that village to a larger city, or if you want to build a dam, no, dam is like too optimistic, a tube well is a big thing, right? Like, you know, you put it in a tube well, it irrigates the farms, all of that stuff. People often don't trust each other, because people think, why should I put in my money? Why doesn't anyone else put in their money? This is sort of the classic economic problem of collective action, which is that everyone wants to be a free rider. No one trusts the other person to do it. Religion over here in many places across the world is sort of the central economic hub of these villages, where what happens is you say, look, don't give me the money. Let's all put the money in the local church. They'll build the tube well. Let's all put in the money in the local mosque and they'll irrigate the farms, because it creates a sense of trust. You stop thinking of these fellow people as just neighbors or economic subjects. You think of them as my fellow Christians, my fellow Jews, my fellow Muslims. And then secondly, storing this money and collectivizing this money within the religious structure of the mosque or the church is often a way to increase trust in these societies rather than decrease trust in these societies. That's another way that religion provides a lot of economic support. The next thing I want to talk about is religion as social community. How does that work? So this is basically just the idea that when you go to church or when you go to a mosque or when you go to a synagogue or a temple, it feels nice, not just because you're in a connection to God, but you're also in connection to others who are in a connection to God. And that really creates a sense of belonging there. You feel like you're making friends, but you're not just making friends in a sort of horizontal sense. You're also making mentors in a vertical sense. You meet people there who are older than you, whose advice you respect. You meet people who might give you counsel, which might change the rest of your life. So often religion often works in a sort of social communal sense. But it's not just religion as a social communal sense of, you make friends. It informs a part of your identity. So that's also another dimension that religion has in terms of social community. You growing up knowing who you are, you know who I am? I'm a Muslim, right? It helps you position yourself in this random universe where you can be anything and hence nothing. So it gives you an identity where you feel like you have a purpose here, you know what you're doing, you know who your friends are, you know what you believe. So that's another thing that really is helpful. The next thing then is religion as spiritual belonging. So this is basically the idea that, did someone have a question? No. This is basically the idea that sort of like, you know, if you take away all of the external stuff, the economic stuff, the political stuff, the community stuff, what religion still leaves is just the matter of you feeling less alone because you have someone on your side. And this often manifests itself in the case of God, right? Like you have a divine superior being who is on your side at all times. And remember, we often think of this like, you know, but God didn't help me there. And I wanted a first in that EC 100 exam. It's not something as literal as that, right? It's more about I didn't get a first in my AC 100 exam, and God was there to listen. So it's much more about the counseling and sort of therapeutic perspective of knowing that God is always with you, as opposed to the literal, like, you know, God will help me get material things that I want in my life. Barira has thrown out a question. The question being, do you feel that there will be any adverse effects if people who want to opt out of the community will find it difficult if it is super integrated? I will be frank, I don't get that question. So did this come from the Zoom call, Barira, or from the Facebook live stream?
This is from me.
Okay, can you explain yourself?
So I was just asking, do you think that sometimes when you live in a super integrated community and you don't necessarily believe in religion, it will be more difficult for you to opt out and, you know, live anywhere else because you have to be part of the social gathering because it is a social community?
Yeah. Do you know what, like, this is an interesting question because it almost like screams for an obvious answer, which is obviously it's difficult, where one would say, like, you know, if it's super integrated, everyone's the same homogenous faith, then they're likely to exclude you, in the worst case, commit violence against you. But I think one thing that people sort of often miss in these debates is that families and communities who love you and respect you are surprisingly flexible when it comes to you. So I've noticed, for instance, that there's a lot of polling data in the Muslim world, which would have, like, on net, a majority attitude, which is anti-LGBT. But I can also make, like, a bet on everything I have that if I have a friend of mine whose parents find out, they would behave differently if it's their own son or daughter, as opposed to if in the abstract they're against it. Does that make sense? So I think that's sort of a nuance that people miss, that people have attitudes in the public space and people have attitudes in the private space. But in the private space, you tend to be much more tolerant of these things than you tend to be in the public space, because then you're not thinking of them as, like, you know, the LGBT other. You're thinking of, oh, this is my son. I taught him how to ride a bike when he was 3. How can I kick him out of my house? Does that sort of make sense? Unfortunately, it still happens. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, this is one of the reasons that LGBT homelessness is such a big thing across much of the world. But I think it tends to happen less than people immediately think, because the fact that you grew up in that community and in that household does tend to mitigate the worst excesses of what your attitudes in the public space would be. There's another question. It has the word symmetric in it. Oh, no. Why are all the economic benefits not equally symmetric with secular governments? So for people who are not debate kids, what this basically means is, can't you get economic benefits from secular governments to an equal extent that you would get them from religious spaces? I think the answer is no, because of the thing that I said about, I mean, it's sort of like a debating thing, right? Like, there's always a counter argument. But the answer would be no, in my opinion, because of how religion sets up cultures of charity giving. So for instance, in secular governments, the way that it works, it's a secular taxation pool, right? So you give in money to a taxation pool. Domestically, it goes towards welfare. Abroad, it goes towards development programs across the world. What happens in the case of religion is that they are, like, localized structures set up to incentivize charity giving. People knock on your door every single day to ask for money. When you go to the mosque, it's always part of the khutbah given by the imam, or a sort of a Sunday sermon given by the priest, right? So, and then thirdly, everyone in that community is aspiring to look like they're charitably giving, which is, again, not necessarily true in secular government and secular people, right? It's not like everyone goes around being like, I gave 500 rupees today, or I gave $10 today. Look at how great I am. People would think that you're weird, right? Like, they would walk away from you. But within religious circles, this idea that you're virtuous is often intricately tied up with the idea that you're charity giving. So I think that's one sort of nuanced difference, how we behave, the idea that secular governments have privatized charity giving and religions have publicized charity giving is how I would sort of think about it. Do you want to follow up on that as well?
Yeah, just a sort of quick question. Why is it epistemically better that you're only giving because you fear the wrath of God or you fear the wrath of your community rather than out of the goodness of your heart?
Yeah, so I would just say, like, I don't care. So, like, for instance, like, if I'm on a date and then there's a homeless guy sitting next to me and I'm like, oh, look, I'm going to impress her by giving him £20 that I definitely can't afford. Does it really matter that I did it solely to impress her if the guy has £20? Like, again, so it sort of boils down to our philosophical difference between intentions and action, where I think that if you have bad intentions, but it reliably leads to good actions, I wouldn't personally morally care. that you have bad intentions. So for instance, in our, like in LSE, like this is like the hub of arrogance. Like everyone does lots of good things to show off, right? What are you doing? I started a tech startup in this developing country because I want to just help the global poor. You know, like there's lots of LSE people. Again, I don't care as long as they're doing it. Does that make sense? Like I'll still make fun of them for it, but I'll still say like, you know, you know what, keep doing it. Even if you're doing it just to like say it. So does that sort of like answer your inquiry? Okay. Quickly, Sunny says, in a debate, is it worth making a distinction between religion and religious institutions? If so, how exactly would you map it out? I think that this question is at the heart of the debate that we're going to debate in 5 minutes. So I think we should perhaps, if the debate doesn't answer it, then you can message me. But the entire debate is basically about this. So hopefully the debate answers your question. Finally, religion as art and culture. So this is something that people often miss, right? So religion isn't just a modality that's accessible to people who are within religion. It's something that's beautiful and can be expressed for people across the world, right? So if you think at some of the most beautiful paintings, beautiful structures, beautiful sculptures that have been set up, they have been commissioned by either, you know, caliphate set up in the golden age of Islam, or during the Italian Renaissance set up by the Catholic Church, right? Like basically every other famous painting or sculpture you can think of comes from those sort of religious spaces. So always remember that religion isn't a thing that only people inside can enjoy. It's also a thing that people outside can enjoy. There is a beauty in partaking in, like, you know, appreciating such fascinating sculptures, such fascinating architectures. And that's the sort of happiness that we share collectively as a human civilization, no matter what our faith is and no matter what we believe. And on that note, I am done. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Hamza, for that truly incisive and great lecture. And I'm sure I'm speaking for everyone when I say that we all learned a great amount. We can now move on to the second part of the event, which is a show debate. We'll make sure that the live stream stops here just before we've taken